So, hello everybody, and welcome to this contributed talk session. It's my pleasure to introduce Deepak Kumar Pradhan from the Indian Statistical Institute. So please, Deepak.
Hello everyone. First of all, let me thank the organizers to give me a chance of speaking here. So let me start today I'm going to talk about topless operator on hard space over the poly disk. So basically one particular kind of topless operator that I want to talk is partial asymmetric topless operators. So let me start with some basic definitions. So let me start here. We first define what is called a hard space over a disk. So here I'm talking about disk, but I'll actually write circles, and there are usual way to identify. So, but there won't be disk appearing anywhere here. So, but you can still say it is hard space over the disk and the point disk. But I'm actually talking about circle and torus. Anyway, so how we define the hard space over the circle is we take all the square integral function with respect to the normalized Lebesgue measure, and we want all the non-negative and we want all the negative Fourier coefficient of f to be zero, and we collect all such f, and we call your Hardy space over the disk or Hardy space over the circle here. And another word that I will be using here, and it's called analytic. We'll call them analytic also at times. So mostly because only the support of this the Fourier coefficients are only on the positive side, so we'll call it analytic. So in hard space over the poly disk will be defined as Hilbert tensor product of hard space over the circles. So you take the tensor products of hard space over the circle n times, and you get the hard space over the poly disk, and that is nothing but the hard space over the usual way when you define with respect to this kind of Fourier coefficient. So we can define the normalized Lebesgue measure on the torus, and you define hard space similarly, and that's what your hard space is S2 of Tn. And this is in fact our ZI invariance of spaces of L2 of Tn, and the notation L is here for Lorentz right now. Sometimes we write it as MZI, but I've written it as LZI. And another very specific class of functions that we're going to talk today is when you take the bounded. When you take functions which are bounded, essentially bounded over Tn, and take common with respect to S2n, then we call it H infinity Tn here. Okay, so let's define what is a topless operator. So for us, a topless operator is once you start with the Lorentz operator, which is just a multiplication by a bounded function. So you take a multiplication by a bounded function on L2 of sigma Tn, and what you do is compress it onto S2 of Tn. And so basically these are, as I just said, these are actually LZI invariant subspaces, and I'm compressing it onto that invariant subspaces, and that's what our topless operator is. And phi will be called a symbol of this topless operator. Okay, and next is an abstract way of defining this topless operators. So basically you start with any bounded operator on S2 of Tn, and we say this is topless with respect to some symbol phi. If and only if T satisfies this particular identity, Tzi star Tzi is equal to T for all I equals to 1 to n. Of course, all multiplication by Zi. So you get this, if the identity is satisfied, you say T is a topless operator. And now, some interesting topless facts about topless operator that we are going to use, we will see in this particular talk today. I've mentioned two of them. And first of all, in general, if you take multiplication on L2 sigma t, or for example L2 sigma t here, and multiplication by this functions phi I, so phi 1, phi 2, they will commute. But when you compress them onto S2 t, they need not commute, of course. And Brown and Halmus gave a characterization in the that when they commute. So this topless operator commute if and only if either both of them are analytic, or both of them are co-analytic. Or of course, one is a linear combination of the other. So basically you can write, let's say phi 2 is equal to something like So alpha phi 1 plus some constant. Okay, so not other polynomials, you can write some constant maybe. Okay, so these are the only topics of the commute. But what is interesting for us is this first condition, which is analytic and co-analytic. So what happens if you see, so there is one more particular class of topics operator that I should mention here. If T commutes with this, let's say T commutes with your TZIs, all TZIs, right? So since TZIs are isomorphs, you can actually check that this commutant relation will also be, give you this particular identity. And these are what I call analytic topics operator, which is coming from H infinity. Okay, and this particular criteria says you don't really, at times you may just come up with a commutant relation with some analytic function, not with TZIs, just analytic topics operator, and then also you'll get the T phi to be analytic. I'll just show, we'll just see what I mean by that, what I'm trying to say here. Anyway, the second important result regarding this Toeplitz operator is what's Berlin's theorem, where one classifies all invariant, Z invariant subspaces of Hardy space S2T as image of isometric analytic Toeplitz operator. So if Toeplitz operator is isometric, we can show easily that it's a unimodular function. And we also say that it's not just isometric, it's in fact, it's coming from H infinity of T. And that's basically the only option that we'll see today. Anyway, so before I can state today's question, so that I'm going to discuss. So let's talk what's a partial isometry. So just a very basic definition, partial isometry is an isometry on the perp of its kernel. So if you take a function in the perp of the kernel, then it must preserve the norm. So then we call U as a partial isometry. And defining property of partial isometry is that U star U will be a projection and U star is again a projection. So those two are very useful and defining property, in fact. And the two notations that I want to fix today is here for this talk is domain of U is, or sometimes called initial space of U, is for which F this U is non-preserving. That's so called U. And the other one is range of U, is usually just written R of U, sometimes called the final space, but we'll just say range here. The main questions that I want to discuss here today is what are all partial isometric Toeplitz operators? So with this particular identity, I want to add another identity. I want to say T satisfies this as well as T star T is again a projection. So in which class we can actually solve this? So this was initially shown by Douglas and Brown for Hardy space over a disk. The result is this: when you start with a non-zero Toeplitz operator, then this Toeplitz operator is partial isometric if and only if the symbol phi is either inner, or the adjoint of the symbol phi bar is, or the conjugate of the phi bar is inner. Okay, so either phi is analytic or phi is co-analytic. So there are only two options: phi is analytic or co-analytic. So let me just just briefly tell you what the sketch proof of this thing. I'll not go through the full proof, of course. The two points that I want to highlight here is first this one, which says domain of any partial isometric Toeplitz operator is in fact a Z invariant subspaces. And as we just show, saw that Berling's criteria gives us a good, it tells you what are all Z invariant subspaces inside S to T. So this is first one. The second one is again the Brown-Elmer's criteria of committing Toeplitz operator, which I mentioned above. So these two are the most important part of this particular proof. And when we ask a question about partial isometric Toeplitz operator on polydisk, then one sees that what kind of serious problem one will run into. So before that, let me just give you some idea of what is going on in one variable before actually going to what kind of difficulty one faces when one tries to solve this kind of problem in multivariable. So what actually is happening is once you start with two invariant subspaces, Z invariant subspaces inside H2 of T, And one can see that this is your Berlin criteria basically. So you can write m1 as theta 1 is 2t and m2 as theta 2 is 2t. And we can choose psi to be a unimodular function, which of course you can define like this. And psi will map m2 to m1. Okay, so that's pretty easy to see. And theta 1 is inner, remember theta from Berlin's criteria, theta 1 is inner, theta 2 is inner. So modulus of them on the circle is 1. So this particular guy here is in fact your unimodular function. But what Brown-Hulmers tells us, if on top of this, if one demands that this T psi to be partial isometry, then you are asking too much. So you can't really get a T psi to be partial isometry unless your one of the functions is the full space. That is, unless theta 1 is unless one theta 1 or theta 2, one of them is constant. So you get either psi to be just theta 1 bar, or that will give you co-isometry, or psi to be just theta 2, that will give you an isometry. Okay. So this is what Brown-Hulmers theorem says in terms of invariance of spaces of H to T. So there is a beautiful connection between invariance of spaces of H to T and this Brown-Hulmers theorem. So let's see what actually holds, what are the difficulties in several variable. So what really holds for several variable, and in fact, one variable also, as we saw, that range of T phi or domain of T phi, both are in fact TZi invariance of spaces. This much is true for both several variable and one variable. But this is the starting of the problem, because as we know, Rudin gave us counterexamples where this in Zi invariance of spaces need not be a Berlin type, as in they are not finitely generated. There are invariance of spaces which are not finitely generated, and there are invariance of spaces which do not even contain any bounded function. But if you look at the earlier correspondence that between two invariance of spaces that I was talking about in one variable, but Rudin says this. He actually gave a counterexample to answering a question of Agrawal, Clark, and Douglas, where he says that you can have such a correspondence between two invariance of spaces with a unimodal function, but that unimodal function need not be a quotient of inner function, which is the case of in case of n. Okay, so this is for n strictly greater than 1. For n equal to 1, you as we just saw, this unimodal function is in fact can be written as quotient of inner functions. Okay, so Rudin provided this kind of example. So that's a big bummer. That's a big issue when you start with a several variable problem, that even the first step of the one variable problem doesn't go through. And the second part is when you had that very good criteria of committing to Toeplitz operators. So what we saw is committing to Toeplitz operators will correspond to both co-analytic or both analytic functions. Here that criteria becomes a bit more complicated, because then you actually see that the commutant relation, the Bayesian transform, so this B is actually the Bayesian transform. The Bayesian transform of the commutant relation is n-harmonic. Not harmonic, n-harmonic. So like it is harmonic in each coordinate, not the summation of that harmonic function is zero. It's just n-harmonic. And that gives, so when we were trying to solve the problem, we didn't really want to go into this particular direction, because here, when you apply Bayesian transform, we again have to go into the disk, because the Bayesian transform is given in terms of reproducing kernel surface. The whole idea of one variable really doesn't go straightforward into the multivariable case. Keep this correspondence in mind, and we'll see it later what's actually going on. So what we tried to do is initially, So what we first tried to see whether these Toeplitz operators can we separate the variables, in the sense that, so what we showed is if you take a partial isometric Toeplitz operator on the poly disk, then the symbol cannot be both analytic and co-analytic in a variable. So if you fix Zi, some variable, so I is in from 1 to n, so if you fix some Zi, so it cannot contain both positive exponent of Zi as well as negative exponent of Zi. So it cannot be analytic and co-analytic at the same time, in the same, in, I mean, not analytic, co-analytic, it should not depend on the same way, the positive exponent of Zi as well as the negative exponent of Zi. So this is the first thing what you show. And from that, by the help of a contradiction, we proved is once you start with a partial asymmetric Toeplis operator, then your phi is your Toeplis operator in fact factors into t phi 1 star t phi 2, where phi 1 and phi 2 are in fact inner functions, and phi 1 and phi 2 depend on different. Let me just clarify what does this mean by saying depends on different variables. So suppose you have two variables, z1 and z2. So phi 1, so what we want to say is, let's say phi 1 and phi 2. So this may not, this phi 2 may be depending on z1 and z2, phi 2 may be function of z1 and z2, or phi 2 may be function of just z1. So in that case, if phi 2 is a function of z1 and z2, phi 1 is just a constant function. If phi 2 is a function of, let's say z1, then phi 1 is a function of z2, and similarly vice versa. So it only depends on one variable at a time. So I mean, mutually exclusive variable, one is a mutually exclusive variable. Okay, so this is what we showed, and that is just by the contradiction. We really don't need at this point, we don't need Wöhling's theorem, and we don't really need commutativity. And this is from the shift operators, one can prove this result that shift as in like the multiplication of a Zi's can be thought as a shift on L2 of n. So n-fold product of L2 of n, of course. So from that itself, one can get this result. So let me just give a very simple example to understand what is going on. And this is actually the template of our examples. If you start with the hardest space of a bidisk, and we consider this particular operator. So we are multiplying with Z2 and then compose it with the adjoint of PZ1. Okay. So this is a partial asymmetric operator. And what it does is it takes Z1 of S2T2, which is a Zi invariant subspace, to Z2 of S2T2. This is again a Zi invariant subspace, which in case of one variable, you cannot have this kind of proper Zi invariant subspaces, which are related via this partial asymmetric Toeplis operator, which is one variable Wöhling's theorem, sorry, one variable Brown-Ahlmann's theorem says. But in two variable, we can have such a thing. And what our results is, these are the only options. So Rudin's examples are not, do not fall in this category. So basically, the domain of T phi is a Zi invariant subspace, and it is in fact a Wöhling type subspace. Similarly, the range, of course, is a Wöhling type subspace. So this now, okay. So but what happened here is when we are talking about this criteria that I just mentioned, this criteria. The one variable criteria is one variable classification is not too much visible, as in what case your T phi is an isometry, and in what case T phi is a co-isometry, and we wanted to nail that down also. So what we did is we'll try to see what happens when you have an isometry is, of course, each isometry is going to be what is called a hypernormal operator. So the commutator is in fact positive. So if phi is a isometry, then you have a hypernormal operator. Okay. And if phi is co-isometry, then the adjoint of phi is, T phi is co-isometry, then adjoint of T phi is hypernormal. So the hypernormal class gives us some hope to nail it down. So if T phi is an isometry, we know it is hypernormal. What we wanted to see is all hypernormal operators will give you the class that one variable classification talks about. So in fact, it is. So when you start with a hypernormal Toeplis operator, it turns out that the factors that we had, T phi and T phi 2, they satisfy this inequality. And here one can see, straight away use Douglas factorization to say T phi 2 is in fact a factor of T phi 1. And moreover, one can also show that this X is again an analytic Toeplis operator. So we can see that this X is in fact commutes with your TZi. So this T phi 1, remember T phi 1 and T phi 2 both are actually inner functions. These are isometries. So you can just take this out from the left. And so you see that X is in fact commuting with these TZI. So X is also an analytic topless operator. So we have our phi 2 is equal to phi 1 times phi. So we have this factorization. But as I just said, if you have a topless operator, which is a partial estimate topless operator, then you have the factorization. The factors depend on mutual exclusive variables. So this particular identity can only happen if one set is constant. So what I mean by that is, if you have a partial asymmetric topless operator, which is also hypernormal, then it is equivalent to saying that phi is in fact an inner function. So the one variable classification actually is the subclass of this hypernormal topless operator inside the class of partial asymmetric topless operator. What I mean by that is if n equal to 1, these two classes are in fact same. So that gives us, okay, so that has given us somewhat closure that we now understand how this one variable classification of Brown and Helmholtz generalized to this matrices over the Paul disk. But still, it is not quite enough because we still don't really understand this example that we have discussed. So what actually is happening here? So what, I mean, not this example, in general, whatever we have written. So if you're looking at this, something like this, we just wanted to understand what this actually does. So we went back to the example again, the simple example, as I said. So what really happens with this example? So you start with the homogeneous decomposition of H2T2, and we can write like this. So each HN is the homogeneous polynomials that we're looking at n of power n. So this HN are in fact reducing under this particular topless operator. So if one wants to see in a grid, so let's, for example, okay, so I'm just slightly jumping few things to say this, that this Z1 and Z2 can be thought of as shifting in this grid, right? So you can go this direction when you multiply by Z1, and you can go this direction when you multiply by Z2. And what this particular operator is doing is when you go like this, first you go like to the right, and then you go down. And of course, this is doubly commuting. So you can go like this and go down, then go right. So that's the same thing. So what is happening here, this topless operator on HN is in fact, is in fact a nilpotent operator. In fact, what is what we will call a truncated shift. So I mean, this is evidently visible once you see this. If you suppose, let me see here. If you start with Z1 power n, if you go to if you first apply Z1 power T Z1 bar Z2 to Z1 power n, okay. So you'll go to first we'll get Z2 Z1 power n. And then TZ1 bar, right? But these two commute, and so then you get one more less, so you get Z1 minus 1, Z2, right? So first you move right and then you move down. So basically that's what is happening. So and so Z1 power n is in fact the image under this map is going to Z1 power n minus 1, Z2. So this is what this particular operator is doing. And what our final classification will tell us is this is in fact all this is in fact the whole picture. Every partial asymmetric topless operator is somewhat going to look like this. So before that, before I come to that part, so we start, what we first proved, I mean, it's not very hard to see otherwise also, but what we first proved is if you start with inner function phi, then T phi is pure. What I mean by pure is if you take an isometry which is which does not have a, in the world equation, it does not have a unitary part. So in that case, we call it a pure. That is what we are calling pure here. And that is T is phi is unitary equivalent to the unilateral shift. Okay. So once you show this, let me define just what's called a power partial asymmetry. Power partial asymmetry is an isometry whose every power, I mean, is a partial asymmetry whose every power is also a partial asymmetry. So that's a power partial asymmetry. The shifts are, of course, unilateral shifts are power partial asymmetry. And what are other power partial asymmetries? Are the truncated shift. But before that, I just want to say this: the partial asymmetry topless operators that we just classified are in fact power partial asymmetries. Okay, so that is again not very hard to see, because when I write like this, t51, t52, and phi1 depends, phi1 and phi2 depends on mutually exclusive variable. That means these two doubly commute, and you can take the powers and just show this. It is a partial asymmetry by taking t5 star t5. Okay, so these are power partial asymmetry, and this is a particular. This is what is the definition of a truncated shift, which is when this basically the Jordan block without a diagonal here. Now Halmus and Wallin has this classification or criteria for what is called, for which operators are power partial asymmetric, and they say it has to be direct sum of unitary operators, pure asymmetry, which I just said are shifts, or pure co-asymmetry, that is pure co-shifts, or truncated shifts, which are this lower triangular important maps that I've written. Okay, so this is the direct sum of either shifts, co-shifts or unitary map and truncated shifts. And then we apply our results that we've just shown, so that it is t5 is pure and you take out all possibilities. So what we finally showed is this partial asymmetric topless operator is either a shift or a co-shift or direct sum truncated shift. That is, the example of TZ1 star TZ2 is the template of all partial asymmetric topless operators, and that's how, and that relates invariance of spaces, in fact, Berling type invariance of spaces of S2T2 via a unimodular map. And that is the final classification. I think I went very fast. I don't know. Okay, so let me just go through this. Brown Douglas was the original paper that I talked about, and Brown and Halmos, of course, the algebraic properties of topless operator is where everything starts. Almost everything started for this topless operator business, and the paper that I just presented here is a co-work. It's a joint work with my collaborator Deepak KD. So I mean, both of us are named Deepak. So Deepak KD and Jaydeep Sarkar, and of course, Rudin's invariance of space problem, and the commutator result for commuting topless operator result for Polydor's case was done by Tao Yu, who in 2017. And yeah, so that would be the reference list. And I'll finish here. Thank you.
Let's thank the speaker. Any question? So I have a question. In fact, it's maybe a naive question. It's a basic question. What is an n-harmonic function?
So I'll write down here. So it's harmonic in each variable. So basically, by harmonic, we mean zi bar, zi of f is 0, right? So you want this to happen for each variable, 1 to n. And this is n-harmonic. In general, harmonic becomes when you take summation over this and f is equal to 0, it's called harmonic in multivariable, and this is n-harmonic. Yeah. So every n-harmonic function will be harmonic, but not vice versa.
Okay. So is it the same that harmonic in several variable? If I take the Laplacian, for example.
Yeah. So for the Laplacian equation is 0 for each variable. Okay, so you can write a full Laplacian equation by summing up the variable. That's not n-harmonic. So n-harmonic is just writing a Laplacian for each particular variable and saying that they are zero.
Okay, thank you. And is there any other question? If not, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.